We're sat on the Isle of Wight now, and this is where myself, Phil and Boone all came from. And I guess this is where we learnt our trade in the music business, really. I started playing drums when I was about 9 years old at school. And I was very lucky because when I was 11, I went to a very good school, Cowes High School, that they were very behind kids playing. You know, they had a very good school orchestra and things like that.
My background, I guess, is very similar to Mark's in that the way I started out was much less organised than like a school music thing. It was like, it was my idea to play, and it wasn't like I was doing other music or anything. And we played in various bands. The only reason we didn't actually get together that often on the island was because Mark was a drummer then, and I guess if he'd been a bass player then, we'd have played a lot more in bands and stuff.
I mean, I sort of started music, the very first thing about music was in primary school. Like a compulsory subject, so I'd like playing recorder and I tried to play violin, but it didn't really strike me as anything then. When I went to grammar school, I sort of gave up music for metalwork and started doing all that. Then when I was about 16, I decided to play sax. I just picked one up one day and liked it, sort of caught my imagination. And then a year later I started playing guitar, and I just started like a sixth form A-level course. As soon as I started playing guitar, I was really hooked. And so A-levels went right out the window.
I'm like the odd one out, if you like, from this location. Because
no colour. Not a colour thing.
Aside from that, I was born in London, and I sort of attended local comprehensive schools. And then at the age of 14, I found out about, or my family found out about, this specialist music school in Manchester called Cheetham's, where they sort of took you on a musical audition, and then you'd like have a first and second study, and you're doing an academic program, but music would be crammed in everywhere else, so you'd be doing orchestra and all that kind of thing. So I went up to that school and boarded out there for 4 years, and then sort of did auditions for the colleges in London, and the only one I successfully got into, or the only one I successfully passed, was for Guildhall.
The sort of the practical side of playing for me came with playing in holiday camps, places like you can see all around here, which is a very big industry on the island. Tourism is, I guess, the biggest industry on the island, particularly obviously this time of year. So there was no shortage of holiday camps and holiday camp bands to play in.
Thank you.
because we all had the same ideals when we left the island. We had the same sort of musical background in terms of what we listened to. There's nothing to see here, nobody to see to play. So you buy records and you get into sort of music that way. And we had all this idea that London was like this incredible place where all these beautiful things are happening, like, you know, all the jazz and stuff. And nothing was happening when we got there. It was totally, total anticlimax.
You know? It was like when we were playing down here, this guy Pete Cotton that we all sort of played with at some time or other in the holiday camps, he was an ex-Londoner, and he sort of advised us, quite sincerely, I'm sure, that you could go down Shaftesbury Avenue and like Phil Seaman would be thrashing the hell out of some drums in a window, and it's incredible, you know. And then he's saying, "Whoa, they're hot in town, mate." So, you know, I obviously didn't want to go to London. I had to go to sort of see it, and I couldn't believe it. You know, it's really just like sort of the streets were paved with gold, which of course, you know, they weren't at all.
Always been intrigued by the fact that now people come and approach me the way I felt about those guys, like Miles Davis or Chick Corea. When I picked up a record by those people, I wondered what they were like, you know, what drove them on. And like, they were just human beings, really, like, underneath all that, you know, enigma that was the way it seemed to me. And like, at concerts, these kids come up and they look at me and they talk to us about as if we're something different, you know. And it's just crazy. It's not what we do and what thousands of other people do across the world is not out of the average person's reach.
Yeah, try and keep the beat going with your foot. 1, 2, 3, 4. The music workshop is the part of the Last Chance Centre that I'm involved with, and that's been running for about 3 years. And it gives kids the chance to play electric instruments and drums and stuff like that, which they probably wouldn't have the chance in school, for example, to play rock music.
Your hand is coming off and you get the snare.
That's all I remember. And it's the same way. You know the old...
Was that at school? Was that private teacher?
That was at school. We used to have two piano teachers.
What sort of made you start playing? It's just interest in music. And the chance to do it was, you know... Yeah. I mean, was this place sort of... Did you know about this place already? Or? No, we found out it was through the guy and the venture broker.
Tony.
No
kid I've ever met has come from school and said they showed me how to play rock music or they showed me how to play an electric instrument. The whole concept of playing something that loud is sort of unheard of at school, you know, and it's something that the kids want to do because the music they listen to is electric music and, they have no chance in a formal academic sense to do that. And that's what this workshop provides, I think.
We're talking about kids now, today, and like we're living in a rock and roll era, if you like. We're living in a very sort of electric age. And times have changed, you know. The one thing I did think that was limiting at school was that sort of blinkered attitude of, well, look, school music lessons are, you know, beat along, two fingers on the palm of your hand, ta 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 ta, while we sing through this song, and maybe we'll do a quick, you know, what is it called when you sing in a, you sing around, yeah, you know, oh, you yeah. sing rounds, like, and the gay robin came running, and la, 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 the gay robin came running, and la, 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 the gay robin came running, and, la, 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 and all that sort of thing.
He's good at that.
Well, that's what it was, you know. That isn't music, you know. I wasn't learning anything there. Now, I'll tell you, right, it's like, I'll explain some stuff about slapping bass, and it's like how I go about doing it. It's like I play off the knuckle. It's like I got a callus built up over a period of time, and it's like fretted instruments like do slap better than like a fretless bass will ever do, because you do actually start working off of the frets, and when you're hammering on, it just worries me how many kids that could have been great players, good musicians, and had careers as great players had it sort of crushed out of them by maybe some negative responses from their teachers and tutors. There's one very good story about a drummer, an American drummer called Billy Cobham, who is really one of the great drummers of all time now. And he went to a tutor in New York, and Billy Cobham has a very unique way of playing. He plays open-handed, and he plays that with his left hand on the hi-hat and his right hand on the snare drum. Although it's like the uniform setup, he's not left-handed, he just plays this way. And he went into this drum tutor, you know, saying, look, you know, let me play like this. And the drum tutor said, no way, you must hold the stick across your hands like this, and you play with your right hand on the hi-hat. You know, that's what drumming's all about, you drum like this. And Cobham said, no, you know, this is how I'm playing. And the tutor said, no, forget it. And Cobham went his own way and went on to become one of the greats of all time. And he actually met this drum tutor years later. And Cobham said, well, I didn't do so bad, did I? And this bloody tutor said, yes, but think how good you would have been if you'd listened to me in the first place and played like this.
Thank you.
like, now start working into like a rhythmic approach, like going, keeping the same time, 3, 4. There you go. Check it out.
Musical education in schools is like all other forms of, you know, streaming education. It's like you do O-level music and then A-level music and then go to college. And you probably do like the grades, like, you know, you have to grade 8 on piano and you go on to what else after that.
Yeah.
All these little sort of carrots they dangle in front of you to sort of make, say, if you do this, you'll be a better musician, you know. And that's just crazy because what it is a system to turn out professional people, like professional players to get into the orchestras or teachers, you know. It's just like a big wheel. And they can't cater for individuals that have another way of thinking. They just can't cater for somebody that says, hey, I don't want to do that. I want to make music like this, you know. Maybe I don't have to hold the sticks like this. I can hold them like that or play left-handed. They can't cater for that. But that's just the nature of a system, any system, you know.
So you're right-handed, obviously, aren't you? So your right hand is then, to begin with, is the right hand on this. So it's going, so you're playing those beats. And whatever's happening is going... Yeah, that's going on all the time. Whatever you're doing there, it's going on. This is going continuously.
That's what I meant before, yeah.
I had one music teacher on the Isle of Wight when I was doing A-level studies here. And all he would talk about was the entries to Bach fugues, you know. Like, he went to college, he had A-level music and stuff, and all he would discuss, you know, he would talk about music in terms of entries to Bach fugues. That's all he ever talked to me, you know, harmony. Like, you know, the harmony, the classical harmony 5-4 and all this stuff. But, I mean, what about the rest of the fugue, man? What happens afterwards, you know? But, like, his thing was, like, this particular sort of specific area was this, like, he was so intrigued by the entry to a fugue, you know? But that, what the hell's that all about, you know? I didn't get anything from that. I'm sure he doesn't, really.
When I went through college, although some of the things I was doing I wasn't that enamoured with at the time, I thought that it'd be a good idea to go through it and finish the course and take what I could out of it. And I'm glad I went to college because, I mean, I learned something about the background in music, which was interesting to me anyway. And I picked up some good things about writing music and so on, which I may use later on. But it's like I'm lucky because I can sort of take what I want from that experience and leave the rest out.
So if you try and play that thing again, but try and keep the hi-hat hand playing every beat. So when you hit the snare, you hit both together. Like, so you're going... You were going, take it off. Try and play it all the time. So.
It depends on the kind of person you are. I find personal discovery much more rewarding and means a lot more to me than having it shown me or taught me. And so what I know, I might be doing everything wrong, but at least it's...
Well, we used to have a mark book situation at school. I mean, like, if you'd done anything really bad, I mean, like, throwing abuse at a teacher,
yeah.
One mark away, 2 marks away. I mean, caught jamming on a piano, which was considered putting a piano out of tune.
Oh, no, I don't believe it.
It was something like 2 marks, plus the fact that he didn't really like it.
Yeah, like, just start trying to play lead stuff now. It's just too early. Yeah, so.
So I should be really playing rhythm.
Yeah, just learn chords so that you start learning about the guitar and how it's sort of how it's laid out. Because it's like you can actually play all the notes on the guitar in the first 5 frets, and then just on the top string you can go up to the fourth octave. But the rest of the guitar is just like repeating notes. So it repeats notes all over it. And just to learn how it's laid out, just the way to understanding how a guitar sort of works. Yeah.
I mean, one of the first things I found was actually getting used to like playing chords with both hands or playing chords with the left hand, whereas before I've been
you know, classically trained. I was playing the bass note with the left hand and the chords with the right.
So you can tell you still like this on some of those.
So, like, I mean, that chord, which you stop playing, you can sort of, like, you've got the freedom of both hands to sort of... tune up here. I found that certain teachers would inspire me to do things, whereas others wouldn't. I mean, this is in other subjects, but I think it has relevance. For example, there was an English teacher at my middle comprehensive school, and she'd come with all these fantastic ideas, and I'd go away and have all, become incredibly creative and write lots of poems and sort of stories and stuff. I couldn't wait for English lessons. And then I went to high school for 1 year before I moved up to this music school. And it was all sort of O-level and A-level and English language and literature. And it sort of, it just boxed up my creativity straight away.
Hey, this song is off about standing in the light. And it's called My Cookie.
Started improvising was like first I'd pick out tunes that I liked, I mean like pop songs at the time or just songs I heard on the radio, and then I'd go to the piano and try and work out, you know, where the tunes were and where the, what the chords were and so on. And then, you know, after playing through them a few times I'd get bored and I'd try and change the chords here and there, and I mean I suppose that's where it starts.
I find it hard to find the chords,
yeah,
and actually move my fingers to get the chords.
Something. The best way, I mean, the way I did it when I first started was like, it was Bob Dylan actually, it's just a Bob Dylan songbook. And all the chords were written out in little charts. So every song that I played was always maybe a slightly different chord that I hadn't learned before. So it's like you sort of go through those songs playing them, and your fingers start moving with the chords, and get, you know, free your fingers. And at the same time, you sort of gradually progress. I mean, when you first start, it just seems like you're never going to learn anything. It takes a long time.
That's what I feel like.
But it seems the best way to learn to me. It's like, you just, without knowing too much about music, you can pick up chord shapes and start understanding, you know, the structure of songs and how they're made.
I said, you want to hear?
Turn pop stars, level 42, are set to play a mere 15 nights at the Hammersmith Odeon.
Looking back, it's so bizarre, it runs in the family, all the things we are.
Mark King and Michael Lindup have been the nucleus to level 42 since they formed in 1980. We caught up with them in rehearsal to find out what keeps them ticking.
It sounds awfully American now, doesn't it? But, you know, I have a lot of respect for Mike's ideas, and,
I have a lot of respect for Mark's ideas.
Well, there we are, you see. And I mean, all sycophancy aside, what goes to make a band is, you know, is the input of other people.
It was always written about us by the gentlemen of the music press that we had this particular type that would come to our concerts that would wear white socks and drive a Cortina and so on.
I have furry dice
and have furry dice and so on. The band doesn't have a sort of a strict audience. It has quite a wide appeal. I mean, it's maybe not very fashionable, but then we've never been fashionable, you know.
And what's wrong with furry dice anyway?
Huh?
when you're not playing, it's just like this rose-coloured memory of like, wow, and the audience going, wow, all in slow motion all the time. But in reality, everyone sort of cranks into this song, which is sort of wheezing and farting like some old barrel organ. Then the band sort of starts, you know, it starts becoming sort of well-greased, and then it makes you sort of feel really proud to be part of something that sort of really can sort of steam along. Like nothing else, actually, I must say at this point. I'm always very modest, but like when we're firing on all eights, it's just great.
Where I still live and where I grew up, and it's a fantastic place to be an aspiring musician because there are lots of venues to play. Well, there certainly were a lot of venues back in the 1970s, and we're going to be coming up in a minute to a little town called Sandown on the Isle of Wight, which is really a tourist destination. There's lots of hotels and bars and a few clubs that we used to play at, the Birdcage. And you'd play in bands with Pete Cotton, and you'd do everything from swinging little quick steps to Stevie Wonder songs. And it's a great grounding as a musician. It gives you some real sense of what music's all about. Of course, we hated all of it. We hated doing it because we just wanted to be in our own band. But on reflection, it was just the best experience I could have had. You see, to the seaside is all hotels, and all of these hotels would always have bands on. When I first met Phil and Boone, I would have been 15 years old, I suppose, and I was a drummer then. I wanted to be a drummer, and Phil and Boone were both playing in a band called Joe Bear on the island that was run by a local sort of music hero, John Wheeler, and Chris Mew, actually, who was another guitarist in the band. I don't even know if the house is still there or not. Yeah. I just want to check that this is Green Lane. Yeah, it is. So this is Green Lane. And we used to rehearse in a garage here at Boone and Phil Gould's mum's house. Joy, she was lovely. And how she used to put up with us making the row that we used to do. You know, it's one of those things, if as kids you just don't really appreciate the stress that you must be putting your parents on. But I suppose that was maybe because, bless her, Joy would have been at work and wouldn't get in till we'd thrashed Seven Bells. And here, this is it coming up now, because I remember that store, which me and Phil used to go and get our ciggies from. We used to smoke Rothmans at the time. And there it is, that's the garage where we used to play behind that little wooden fence. It's number 47, the legend that is. Yeah, 47 Green Lane, fantastic. It's probably split up into a few houses now. But, yeah, that's where it all really started, with Level 42. When we rehearsed there for a few times, when we did rehearse there for a few times as Level 42, I mean, obviously, we'd all moved to London by this time. And the fact that we were rehearsing there as the band is because we had a gig coming up at Le Babaloo Club, which was sort of a trendy nightclub on the island, disco, as it was called then, on what was the site of the old Ryde Airport. And they used to have go-karts and things there, and it was kind of the place to go. In fact, I wrote my dad's Austin Allegro off outside there when I just passed my driving test when I was 17. It's very traumatic. I'm standing on the site, next to the site of La Babaloo Club, which was the club that Level 42 got signed to Polydor Records at. It's here on the Isle of Wight. And it's important to us because we'd had Love Meeting Love and Flying on the Wings of Love released on Elite Records, and our contract was up, so we needed to be signed. And it's the thing that got us first going, really. It was a great, sweaty little club. We can't show you the site because it's the home of a multinational burger chain, but I'm going to hold a poster up in a minute and you'll see what it is. I'm a highly respected member of the local community. You know, this is not good. To have a major label come down and be interested was something. And so they sent a dude down and his secretary, but as I remember it, I think he was more interested in his secretary than he was us. Hello, mate. Do you remember that?
No.
Can I go and sit in the car? But something must have worked right, or she must have put out, because 2 weeks later we got signed. And the next thing they said, yeah, we'll offer you a three-album contract. And, you know, we had no idea if we were going to be doing it a week later or not, you know, so it didn't really make any difference. I do remember us saying that if we were together in 5 years' time, you know, we'd eat our hats. And here we are, 32 years later, eating our hats. This Sandown Pier, that used to be quite a good gig. Can't be too many piers left around the country now that still work. This is one of them. Freddie and the Dreamers always used to be on there for some reason. Why am I laughing? Did some musicals there, did Camelot. You could always be working, there was always plenty of places for musicians to play. But we had to get to London, because London was where it was all going to happen. I bought the old milk van that I used to work on, a milk round over in Girdon, and I sort of just chucked everything, my drums, my record collection, you know, my few clothes, and in the back of the van, and off I went to London to see if I could make it work, which was very fortuitous, because, of course, that's where I was able to meet up with Mike Lindup, who was studying at the Guildhall School of Music, and he'd met Phil Gould because Phil was at the Royal Academy of Music. Those guys kind of did it the right way. They were smart, and they had a university course that they were on, so they were kind of getting a grant and stuff. But for me and Boone, we just sort of went up and tried to wing it and see what would happen. You know, when you leave somewhere like the Isle of Wight and you move to London, you don't know anybody. A city is a hard place to make friends. So you tend to gravitate towards people that you knew before, and that's why I think I ended up still seeing Phil and Boone. And originally, Dominic Miller, who's the guitarist with Sting and just as Dominic Miller, a solo artist, was coming along to play guitar with us and jam. But Dom has never done rehearsals, so he kind of dropped out. And so Boone sort of took over the guitar role. So this is my JD Supernatural SA003A, and I bought it in 1980, with the very first advance that we got from Polydor Records, which was £5,000. But the £5,000 had to be divided up sensibly, because we needed to get a van, we needed to get, I think, an amp for Boone, we needed to get a Fender Rhodes and a synthesizer for Mike and an amplifier. And we needed to get a bass guitar and a bass amp for me. And so we sort of figured out that everyone could have £500 budget. Unfortunately, this bass was on sale, but I don't know, about 700 quid, I think, in Sounds in Charing Cross Road. But I said to the guys, look, you know, I've only got 500. Would you take 500 for it? Because it was actually being sold SOR, which is sale or return. So it was being sold on behalf of John Diggins. And they called the guy up and he said, yeah, okay, but no case. So I sort of paid the money and wandered home with this bass guitar just under my arm. But it was fantastic, and it was incredibly fortuitous for me because the bass itself has got a sort of quite a unique sound. And it became synonymous with me all through the early 80s. And what's really nice about the bass is that you see all of this is just worn because it was, I just used to play it. That's called buckle rash, because of the 1980s fashion of having high waistbands, and belt buckles used to grind all that away. This is just worn. That's just where the lacquer and the colour has been worn away. It's just back to the mahogany now, that looks like. You know, that's good, honest wear and tear, because that's how much we were gigging back then. This is its third set of pickup covers, because they're wooden pickup covers, and it just ground away. And like the little, all that grind there, that's just from where I snap and pull the string. And it's just been a beautiful bass, really, all these years. And I mean, I'd never part with it, you know, unless the money's right, of course. Every man has his price. Well, my thumb is my thumb, but I always wind tape around it. Because in 1981, I did split my thumb quite badly when we were on tour in Holland. And just in one great sort of groin thrusting moment of pow, I hit it and it burst. And it just so happened the bass out, because I had more than one JD, and it was called the Starchild bass. And it was had these very nice things. In fact, Morgan Russell, the guy that runs my website, owns that bass now. And it's white, and we were on tour in Holland, and I smacked this thing and the blood went everywhere, which must have looked like some kind of cheap publicity stunt thing. But the fact of the matter is it must have looked great. And the audience were retching and, oh my God, you know. And they used to call me the butcher. There was a couple of German things that came out, sort of Dutch things called de Boule. And so I had it made up into a plate and stuck on the front of my Trace Elliot amplifiers, which I was using at the time.
feels different now.
I've been pretty lucky over the years, though, because this has now become the Mark King signature model that JD makes. Alembic basses that I use after that, they do a Mark King signature model as well. Westone did a Mark King signature model. And then there's the King bass with status basses that is the Mark King model. They're the ones that I currently use, signature model as well. And Fender Deluxe Jazz basses, they did a Mark King signature model. I'd do anything for money. I know we were a jazz funk band, but I tell you, we did like the party. Favourite tipple? My poison was Stroh rum, dark rum. It's actually an Austrian rum. It's strong as hell. It's like 80% proof. And you could get in a mess really quickly with that, you know, and a bit of Coke used to help it go down because it was like paint stripper. And we used to have on the rider, we used to have a bottle of Woods 100 dark rum, which is sort of sailor strength rum or something. And I remember one time when we first had it on the rider, we thought it would be a good idea if we all had a cap each before we went on just to sort of settle our nerves. And we never ever did that again because we were so crap. And it's really hard to play when you've had a drink. Boone used to have Ballantine's whiskey for him. There'd be beers for Phil, I suppose. And we had Dr. Cox Drink 10, which was a multivitamin drink for Mike. But we did party. We partied a lot, you know. It was sort of pretty wild times. The 1980s were full of it. Fantastic, you know. It was a very hedonistic era. And and boy, we made the most of it too, you know. You can't do it for long because inevitably you sort of, you know, when you're burning the candle at both ends, something has to give. And I've always had a rule since is that you don't drink until you come off. When you come off, then we have a drink, you know. And boy, do we drink, you know. Nowadays, of course, it's red wine. It's a lot more sophisticated. But, you know, mid-80s, that you couldn't get wine. There was Black Tower and Blue Nun, which even thinking about it gives you a headache. And that's why it always lasted so long, is because you'd have to gag your way through a glass at a time. You know? And I do know this because my dad, bless him, was a big keen Blue Nun drinker. And he used to buy a box of 12 and he'd say, come on, kids, I've got the Blue Nun in. Dad, you don't get it. You know? It's horrible. I'm sitting in a bar in the hotel on the seafront in Viareggio in 1986 with my buddy Boone Gould. We're on tour in Italy. We're parked in Viareggio because we can go to Rome, we can go to Firenze, we can go to Pisa, we do all these things and then come back and stay in Viareggio. Just outside the bar, there's a beach and it's full of Italian babes, all with their tops off, because they used to do that then. And our tour manager, Roger Searle, comes into the bar and says, hey guys, Deutsche Grammophon, which is the German Polydor, have just phoned and said, Lessons in Love's gone to number one. And it was awesome. And I just remember looking at Boone and thinking, yeah, this is what it's all about. It's fantastic. It's such a different, just a different thing from where we all started on the Isle of Wight, you know, it's incredible. Well, the thing is, it was surreal because it, you know, that it's what you really want. You want to be successful. You want to sell a lot of records, but we were selling a lot of records anyway. You know, it was something that the band had always seemed to be able to do. And I think that was because of the nature of the music that Level 42 made. And also the time that we were in too, the 1980s, just made the whole thing, you could do anything. It's not half as one-dimensional as it is these days. And I feel sorry for sort of up and coming musicians because I think there's some much narrower opportunities in terms of what you can put out, your output as a musician these days isn't anything like as broad as it was when I was doing the thing with the boys. Okay, so it's late 1982 and we get a call from Polydor Records, A&R, Alan Sizer, saying would we be interested in Earth, Wind & Fire, particularly Larry Dunn, Verdine White from Earth, Wind & Fire, producing our next album, which would be album number 3. We couldn't believe it, man. We were blown away. You know, this is going to be our chance to work with some of the biggest jazz funk names from the United States. These were the guys that we'd been listening to. These were everybody, anybody who was in jazz funk. The whole Brit funk movement was kind of based on what was coming over from across the pond. And here they were asking us if we'd like them to produce our album. It's fantastic. We had a meeting with them and, let's go. So we flew out to Los Angeles. We booked 3 months in the Complex Studios and we had a couple of apartments rented in Marina Del Rey, I think it was. And it was just a wild time. We had a couple of cars, a couple of I don't know what they were. They weren't Mustangs, but there was a couple of nice cars rented. And here we are. It doesn't get much better than this. You know, we're 23-year-old boys from London. And we've gone out now to work with some of the biggest names in jazz funk. You know, that it really doesn't get much better than that. And when we mixed the album, we mixed it, I think it was Chris Brunt engineered, did the engineering for us. And Chris had done a lot of the Stevie Wonder stuff too. So it was just wonderful being able to sit with him in Indigo Ranch up in the Hollywood Hills with this fantastic bowl of stars that you get up there. And licorice jelly beans and all of this kind of thing while the album's slowly being cooked together. And it gave us our first top 10 hit here in the UK. It gave us The Sun Goes Down. Up to this point, we'd been sartorially challenged, I think it would be fair to say, in as much as we just used to swap T-shirts and things. In fact, there's some photographs from the past that I can remember seeing through where, in one shot, Boone would be wearing a level 42 football jersey. And then, like, 2 weeks later, in another shot, I'm wearing that very same level 42 football jersey because there's only one. And then we used to just do that. It didn't, you know, we'd go and buy our stage clothes from Millets or the local sports shop, which is like a lot of singlets and that kind of thing, because we just didn't have a clue. It's not where we were coming from. We weren't like the New Romantics. We weren't being driven by fashion and style. We were being driven by the need to get up and play and just play as hard and fast as we possibly could. But when we started having some hits, then the record company started taking it seriously, and there was a lot of, you know, sort of chin scratching going on, and money was being spent on making sure that we did this right. And we had a stylist come in and she dressed us. And so we had all of these sort of really cool clothes for the first time. And this is just sort of pre Miami Vice time too. So there's a lot of rolled up sleeves going on and a lot of sort of hair in the breeze vibe going on. But it was great, and we kind of took it on board too, because it was important. And I think that it started laying the foundations for the fact that we could really cross over here and start having some successful hits. All through the 80s, I mean, we had some good breaks. You know, we got to open for The Police in 1981, that took us out into Europe for the first time. We toured, we did a very big tour in, I think it was 83 or 84, with Queen, going once again across Germany, France and Germany, actually. And that was pretty wild, because much as we didn't really hang out with the Queen guys very much, we did get to open the show for them, along with Jimmy Cliff and Roger Chapman, who used to have a band called Family. And of course, because it was all part of this festival vibe, and it was like really red hot in the sun, and being German festivals, there was just so much stuff to enjoy that we did, you know, and it's just this great haze of overindulgence again. It was a hedonistic time. That's what the 1980s were. You know, it was the same on the Madonna shows. We opened for Madonna around America in 87. Our day's work was done by 8 o'clock every day. And what the hell else are you going to do? You know, when you're in some of the biggest venues in America, in the world, obviously, you know, and everybody wants a part of it because you're part of the show. You know, I mean, you get waiters in the bars that just be coming up, offering you free rounds. And then kicking their legs high in the air, saying, "Is there any chance you can get me an audition as one of Madonna's backing dancers?" But free drinks are offered, so you say, "I think we probably could, yeah, put a word in, you know, and can I have another Corona?" All dayers, all nighters, sole weekenders were amazing things. I'd never knew they existed until we started getting invited along to them. And they were all run by the funk mafia and this, like, gang of DJs that were... they do things like they just do a weekend at Caister, which is a holiday camp up on the East Coast. And it was incredible because you get, I don't know, 1,000, 2,000 kids that go up there and just stay there the weekend, and they just dance all the time. They'd just be dancing. And so there'd be this constant turnaround of bands and artists, and sometimes you go up just to do a guest thing. Sometimes you go up to do live performances. The live performances weren't so much. We'd done a couple of those, and that's always much more stressful because you'd go and sound check in the middle of the afternoon, and then you'd have to hang around while all of this stuff is going on until like 3 a.m, when then you go on stage and stuff. But one of the most sort of toe-curling experiences was doing a mime where we went up to promote Flying on the Wings of Love, which was our second single for Elite Records. And Mike was carrying the lead vocal on that. And I wasn't singing on it at all, but Mike and I have been sort of scooted up there to help promote it by Polydor Records. And So I said, well, what am I going to do? Because I'm not doing anything on this. And they went, well, just play tambourine. So Mike's miming, you know, I am flying, I'm on the wings of love. And I'm stood next to him with a tambourine, you know, it is awful. It's just absolutely dreadful. And I remember thinking then that I'm not really cut out for this business. Not at all, you know, not the bullshit side of it. This sort of stuff, it doesn't really work for me, you know. I'm best when I've got a bass guitar in my hand and, I can sort of just get on and do it then and play really fast. That's what I do. The punters were just kids who were looking for something else. You know, they were looking to do something for a weekend, just the same as kids do now, you know. I remember that by the time we'd sort of become the old guard in 1989 and 1990, and kids were having raves. But a rave was just an all-nighter or a weekend. It was exactly the same thing, you know. And so we weren't taking E because that didn't really start popping its head up until about 1985. And that's when it started becoming the drug of choice of people. But before that, there were other things, you know. So people were doing speed and cocaine, drinking phenomenal amounts of booze. Well, technologically, things were just about to burst through here. This is pre-digital. This is a pre-digital age. And there was talk about that Sony were coming up with this machine that would record everything digitally. In other words, that there was just... And they were talking about sample rates, which is how many times a second it would take a snapshot of the sound wave. And that being the case, that meant that you were going to be able to start sampling things. And I remember Larry Dunn had one of the first emulator samplers I'd seen. It was a keyboard. It had these big floppy disks, these big 7.5-inch floppy disks that you used to put in, and the disk drive would go clunk, 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 clunk. And then you go... And it'd be a dog barking. But you could play a tune with a dog barking, and everyone's just going, it's unbelievable, you know, what you can do nowadays. And that's when the whole looping idea came. This was still ahead of the looping thing, because Afrika Bambaataa and all of the stuff that was just going to sort of explode in New York hadn't really happened yet. And that was sort of going to happen in 1984. And it was in 1984, actually, when we did the lay down the track for Hot Water, and we were mixing with Ken Scott. By this time now, we were now using a solid-state Logic desk. But part of the technology in the studio were the AMS digital delays. And it was about £1,000 per second of sample time you could get. So I think it was Steve Levine had an AMS digital delay that you could sample, you could lock in up to 6 seconds of audio and then play it back by pushing the button. And you had this very sort of basic way of editing. The one that we had the facility to at the studio where we recorded Hot Water had 1.9 seconds of memory time. But it was enough to be able to go diddle-diddle-diddle and diddle-diddle-diddle. And so I could like chop in all these different parts of the sax lines and things and chop it all up and basically form the track that became Hot Water just by sitting in the studio, because the actual track Hot Water is very different from the 12-inch and the single version than it is the original one that we laid down for the track. And that was just technology and how technology had changed things. And that was through watching Afrika Bambaataa on a documentary talking about what was going to be happening. And that was, it was quite a big moment for us, putting out Hot Water, because it was quite seminal and I think it was quite revolutionary. And it's the only time I've ever had other artists coming to me asking if I could produce songs for them. Here's my boy, Pete Ray Biggin. He's on drums with us these days. And what's beautiful about Pete is, apart from the fact that he's a fantastic drummer, is the fact that he first played with us when he's 11 years old. He came along to a sound check that we were doing at the Leeds University. And his mum and dad brought him along, and he just came up and said, can I play with you guys? Yeah, I said, yeah, go and have a go. Get on Gary's drums. And Gary was really sweet with him. And I said, you know, what songs do you know? And he said, all of them. And he did. He was just fantastic, you know. And he was 11 years old, and we just thought, wow, this kid's going to be something when he's older. And he really is. It's great. So it's fantastic having him in the band now. And here he is lecturing after Joss Stone. And that's the next big thing. That's my daughter, Marley. She's going to be amazing too. Yeah, I'll tell you, I loved doing the gig at Metropolis. And I know Mike loved it too. Because it really was like a throwback to the very beginning when we did play at places like Le Babaloo Club and the 06 and the Gold Diggers in Chippenham. It's very, very close. I've played in so many venues and I played at like Soldiers Field in Chicago opening for Madonna, and there's like 112,000 people there, but they're not there to see us, so it's not intimate. But I can play Wembley Arena, which has got 11,000 people in it, and it feels very intimate because they're all there to see us, and that's the whole thing. It's about the relationship that you have with the audience. So it's not, it doesn't have to be a tiny gig. It can be a big gig, but it can still be intimate. However, having said that, there's something that's just venal about being in a club where the people's faces are this far away from you, and they can see, they know what you're doing. It, you know, that you can never fool a punter. The punters know when you're bluffing or not, you know. And we never bluff. Oh, the 80s did everything for me. You know, I can't believe how lucky I am to have had my career in the 1980s, because we were able to make the most of the fact that the 60s everything exploded, the 70s everything started being consolidated, and the 80s was the last decade when you could do anything you wanted to do and build a career on it. And it's changed since then. The 1990s just got so boring, and it's just been the same ever since. It's been sort of one-dimensional. I'm so glad I had my career in the 1980s.
The Isle of Wight, laid back, relaxed, they like to call it the Sunshine Isle. Here in the 70s, a young group of musicians used to play the pubs and clubs, and you could probably get to see them for the price of a drink. Now, by the 80s, they'd become the band Level 42, playing stadium gigs with the likes of Madonna and on their way to selling 30 million records. It was a track called Lessons in Love that brought international superstar status, and it all began back on the island.
The brothers, Boone Gould and Phil Gould, and I sort of met at a party. I got the chance to join the band that they were in. I mean, obviously the Isle of Wight is a largely tourist-based place, and so there were hotels you could play in and pubs and holiday camps for days here, you know, so there was just loads of opportunity to work as a working musician, really learning a trade.
Leaving the island behind, the band started to take shape in London, moving from playing instrumental jazz funk to more commercial pop. In 1986, following their first top 10 success in America, they were asked to produce a hit single in advance of the next album, and it had to be big.
And for me, I just thought, well, okay, fine, let's do it then. You know, let's try and do that. We'd already sat down and made a decision that if we wanted to carry on in the business, we had to reach, you know, it was all very well doing 60,000 units of an album and stuff. If we wanted to go to 600,000 every time we did it, we needed to have sort of bigger hits. And so I just thought, okay, let's have a go at it.
Mark found inspiration remembering his younger days back on the Isle of Wight.
When playing in holiday camps on the island and playing something like We'll Meet Again, the Vera Lynn song, because it's big with the holiday camp people at the end of the night, there's something in there and you think, that is such a great chordal sequence, you know? I might use that somewhere. We'll meet again, don't know where. And that sequence that, you know, although I'm sat there and I hated playing that because I thought, I'm 15, I shouldn't be doing this. I couldn't get that idea out of my head, so, and that's where the I'm not proud, I was wrong, and the truth is hard to take.
We'll meet again, don't know where.
And the bass featured really heavily on that record.
Do you know, Carrie, it's still one of the hardest lines to play, you know, and I play some hard lines. But holding that going, because it's relentless, it just never stops.
Thy phone lies lost at sea. I've been trying to reach your shore here.
So the band wrote a hit to order, and it worked. Selling many more than the desired 600,000 units, it was a huge global success. But not everyone was happy. The Gould brothers, Mark's friends from the island, felt the track took the band in the wrong direction.
Do you think that they were struggling with the record and the sound of the record itself, or with success?
Probably a bit of both, you know. And I didn't know at the time that was going to be probably the highest point for the band. But also what would be almost the architect of the band's downfall, I think, because it was so successful. And yet not everybody that was involved in making it happen really wanted it to be that way and wanted to follow that route. You know, you either go with it or you don't go with it. And I wanted to go with it. I think it was the beginning of the end for the original lineup of Level 42.
The Gould brothers both left the band. But despite a changing lineup, Level 42 went on to have another dozen top 40 hits. Now, preparing for a new tour, Mark's reworking some of those hits, including Lessons in Love.
If you would have said to me when I was 9 years old, 10 years old, you know, do you want to be successful? Do you want to be famous? And I did. That's all I wanted to do, was be in a band and be successful. And I wanted to be on telly and do all of those things. And here was the perfect vehicle for it, you know. I'm really grateful to the song.
And Mark is with us now. And Mark, you said there that that was kind of the beginning of the end, really, that song, for the group, the original lineup.
Yeah, for the original lineup, for sure, Matt, yeah, it was. Yeah. You know, we've been together, you know, a number of years and have been enormously successful. And, yeah, and of course, the success and the amount of hard work that you put into doing that, you know, takes a toll.
And but you're back on tour now with Mike.
I am, yes. Mike Lindup, Mike and I have been working together for the last 10 years again, and he's such a great musician to play with anyway. And
you're having more fun now than you were back then, pressure.
Yeah, yeah, because there's no pressure. I don't have to compete with these young Herberts anymore, you know. I can spawn about and keep my chickens at home on the Isle of Wight every couple of years go out on the road again. It's beautiful.
Yeah, but the young ones, see, they didn't develop the flat bass, did they? Which is a sort of combination of drumming and bass playing.
Yes, it is, for sure, Alex.
Very noticeable, Al.
Wow.
It's, you know, I began as a drummer, and so for me, the whole idea of actually using, you know, two hands to do something, as opposed to the usual.
Oh, yeah! Woo! Yeah.
Very good.
Just peel one of those off.
Well, as you're here, and as you've brought your guitar, we're going to play this little game now, OK? So the idea is, we've got Carrie and we've got Joe, and what we're going to do is we're going to play Ace of Bass.
Ooh! You're playing too. Tell you what it is.
Yeah, tell me what it is.
And the whole idea is that Mark's going to play a little riff of the bass line, and then you have to guess.
And we're going to sound really, really stupid.
It's sort of a little bit like Name That Tune, really. So grab a card and a pen. Oh, there you are. So you write down what song you think it is. No.
Oh, no.
On your own.
I have a pen.
OK, ready? Do you want to launch into this one? OK, here we go. Have a guess what this is, yeah?
Confused, bless him. He's too young.
Before your time, kid.
He's too young.
Isn't it?
Andrew,
sorry.
I get around.
It was really good.
Okay.
It's all right. You just see this.
I get around.
Carrie.
Joy Division. Oh, yeah. Oh, look, there was a pass.
Yes.
Extraordinary.
Yeah.
It is. It was
Joy
Division's Number Terrace
apart. I know that song.
Where's the matter with me? Oh, have we got to get through?
Oh, the Brute
is
there.
Gonna play them.
It doesn't
matter. Okay, let's move on to the second.
Okay, yeah, but this one, right, Sidi. Good luck with this one, kid.
You'll get this, Joe.
Okay, here we go, yeah.
Oh, come on.
I know what it is, but I don't know what it's called. Stevie. I wrote something wrong.
I can see it all over. Stevie Wonder. No.
No. I'll let a sheltered life.
Stick to sending people to sleep.
Oh, Jackson man. 5.
Yes,
I want
Jackson
back.
5.
Was it Jackson 5 or the Jacksons?
No, Jackson 5.
Carbuncles.
There it is, yeah.
Now, Mark, you're just back from doing a tour of America with the fabulous Madonna. How'd you get on with the blonde bomber?
The blonde? She's very nice. I got on very well with her. I mean, I didn't have anything to do with her, to be quite honest.
You sort of read funny things in the press occasionally from time to time. They seem to make up lots of stories and they look for things that really aren't there. I mean, the unfortunate thing was we were just opening for her and that was it. I sort of said hello to her about three times. We threw a party she came to one night. She had a great time. She danced around a lot. You know, it was very much sort of business as usual. You know, if anything, I'd say that she's perhaps a bit lonely, you know, because she's such a big star.
What, was Sean locked up and stuff?
Well, I don't know, you know. He was at a couple of parties that I'd seen. See, already now it's two parties. It must have been good fun then, yes.
But, I mean, things are getting pretty hectic for you guys now.
I mean, no more sort of hectic than they would appear to have been for, like, the last 7 years.
Yeah.
You know, of doing this. What we are doing is we're making a concerted effort to break into the American market now, which we started with the World Machine album and Something About You, and now Running in the Family's just been out and Lessons in Love is a hit. Running in the Family looks a bit shaky at the moment.
Well, I just want to take you back to the slightly more carefree days of, like, 1983. When, you know, like things were beginning to go away, you know, go well, when must it go away? And, like, success was, you know, maybe in sight and stuff. What were your ambitions in those days? What do you think you're going to get out of it?
I think sort of the ambitions are always the same, that you want to be as popular as possible. I mean, everybody, you know, you don't get set out to do this. I'm sure, I haven't met anybody that sets out to do this that wants to be unsuccessful or not popular, you know. Mm. Everyone seems to sort of shy away from the word of, like, oh, commercial, you know. Mm. When we started out, we began in 1980, we were sort of quite an underground thing. We were quite hip to a very sort of small number of people. And that was all very well and good. Mm. We didn't necessarily sort of... We weren't necessarily a part of that circle before they started liking our records.
Now I think we're going to come to what we all here think is probably the best video you've made. I'm sorry. We've got The Sun Goes Down coming up right now. I said, there's definitely a video that a lot of us here at Night Network hold close to our hearts.
Well, do you know, a funny thing, because the very man... Oh, there we are. There we are, David. The very man that is working the machines, it was the director of that video, David Hillier.
David G. Hillier, well, a round of applause.
No.
But, maybe not a round of applause.
He was overpaid, as it was.
Does that take you back at all, I mean, looking at that video? Does it make you feel more relaxed, or...?
No, not really. I mean, it just seems like part and parcel of the, you know... what we were doing and what we were trying to do. I mean, like, you've got to remember that was 1983, quite late 1983. We've been going, like, for nearly 4 years then. Mm-hmm. So, you know, once again, it wasn't a case of, we just appeared on the scene with The Sun Goes Down. Mm-hmm. You know, we actually sort of limped onto the scene in 1980 with Love Meeting Love, you know, which rocketed to 64, anchored itself on the charts, you know. It's very funny, because if you keep butting around, you are...
Very funny, because like these, the DJs that talk to us now, and they say, you know, we love you guys. We've always loved you guys.
I'm not a DJ, though.
I'm a lover. No, not you. DJs. You're a, what are you? You're a VJ, I suppose, aren't you?
Well, just something totally out of this world.
Dread to think what you are. Ooh, slow burn to left.
But I mean, to get onto the lyrics, now, who writes the lyrics for the song?
Well, the lyrics are written by the brothers Gould. That's mm-hmm. Boone Gould, yeah. The guitarist, and his brother yeah. Phil Gould. They're sort of quite intense, arty guys that way. So it's
how important to the Level 42 sound are the lyrics?
Oh, to the sound?
Well, I mean,
how important are the sound of the lyrics? Well, they're pretty. They're quite important, I suppose. Yeah. Isn't it?
When you're performing, do you respond more to the lyrics or to the music?
I don't know, lyrics take on a meaning. It seems to work with us is because we generally start with melodies first that then poor Phil and Boone have to sort of fit words to. So it's like I give them a melody line that goes, and Phil comes up with, I don't want to go to war, I don't want to go to war, or something like that.
So generally the music comes first.
Yes, it does, yeah.
And what do you feel is music's role in pointing out what's wrong in the world?
Well, it's pretty important, you know, that if you're in the position to be on a platform, that we get accused very often of sitting on the fence politically or with issues and stuff. It's not strictly true. What we do feel, rather than coming down that we're not sort of left or right wing or whatever, we do sit there and say, listen, you know, like if Thatcher's got problems...
We've got the chant that's just begun coming up right now.
Oh, I see you're rolling this up.
He's giving me 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5. Sorry to interrupt you there, Mark.
Oh, that's all right. As I was going to say, that video sort of points out that we were very concerned with conservationism at the time there, with that song, and we were talking about trees destroyed by acid rain, which right now is an issue. You know, it seems annoying that we can't be part of the 30% club, as it's called now, you know. The other countries in Europe, are doing this. It's a problem, and that's what we were singing about there. If we think that there are massive problems in other things that we can talk about,
what else do you feel strongly about?
I feel strongly about not being very rich yet. I feel really strongly about that, you know. 7 bloody years. I don't know.
But, I mean, 7 years...
You're not asking the wrong guy, but it's like, we feel strongly about lots and lots of things. You have to temper the fact with that, like, we're a band and we're making music. And in that respect, it's as easy as this and this to sort of turn it on or off, or to, like, particularly in America, you're always reminded of the fact that you have scan buttons on the FM radio stations whereby you can go click
and you're onto another station, and it just searches through just like that and that and that. If you don't like it, you hit the button. Yeah. You get into the habit of saying, had enough of that, hit the button.
Well, you've over 7 years, you've built up a large following. I mean, can you describe to me, how do you see, what is a typical level 42 fan?
Well, he's not dressed unless he's wearing one of these. One thing, but you can win this later.
When the competition comes up.
What's the typical level 42 fan like? I don't know. It's probably a really nice guy with a finely tuned ear.
What about the rest of the band? How do you see them?
I see them, as little as possible. Such a wacky boy. Now, how do I see the rest of the band? We work together an awful lot. That they're good blokes. We're mates. I don't think that we'd have been together as long as we have been if we hadn't been such good friends, you know. It's very hard living with each other 24 hours a day. I see more of them than I do my wife and kids, you know. My wife, you know why.
When you're abroad, is there like a lot of competition, you know, when groupies come in on and all that sort of stuff?
Oh, no, dear. No, there isn't. Absolutely not. What do you mean, groupies? I know what they mean, dear. Come of course on. There isn't. You know, I'm quite happily married with two children. Phil, the drummer, he's married. What, a competition between each other, you mean?
Well, maybe, yeah.
No, I mean, these are dangerous times, you know.
The next video coming up, we see you sitting on a train, right? You're looking at the band, they're all vying for a sassy chick. Yes. And guess who gets it in the end? Yours truly. Well, coming up now, we're going to see if Mark gets it or not. Something About You.
She ought to get it.
You've already heard mention of a competition, and now it's competition time. It's competition time. Well, Mark, look, talking of style, I see you're sporting a very fine level 42 jacket there.
Yes, I am, yes.
And fans at
Levi's.
I've done a bit of arm twisting, and Mark's prepared to give this jacket away. Sorry, you can't have the suntan, though. He's going to give it away to the first person with the correct answer to this question. Which member of level 42 does not come from the Isle of Wight? Answers on a postcard, please, to Level Jacket, Knight Network, P.O. Box 50, London SE1 9LQ. OK, Mark, do you want to just carry on? I mean, you know, is the vest... No, we're not throwing the vest in as well. Back to that last video you saw, you looked pretty knackered. I mean, was that because you actually got the girl in the end, or did it have something...
Tell me what you really think, Kain.
Well, I mean, you know, it must be strains of work.
Yes, no, the video was sort of loosely based, very loosely, because, like, one's acting isn't what perhaps it should be, on the character Archie Rice that Laurence Olivier played in The Entertainer. And it was the whole idea, because I thought that film had a great impression on me of the way that he couldn't cope with things, and it was building up, and it was sort of coming out in his character. And the idea of, like, being sat on a train is that I'm sat looking at these other guys... sort of imagining what they do, and then because of my paranoia, I'm imagining them with my woman, who was Sherry Lungi, who was on television last night, the night before last or something.
Oh, a couple of nights ago now, a couple of nights ago.
Oh, I like it, Sherry. And, you know, that's just it. And I just put them in that situation. It was good fun to make that one. And it was damn expensive, David Hillier, which is probably why he didn't show very much of it.
To come on now to the band's image, I mean, has Level 42, do you think, created its own style? I mean, we've got these dashing denim jackets. I mean,
well, yeah, I mean, of course, we invented denim jackets, you know. <It's>, we were the first ones. I don't know. The style is in sort of quite short supply, really. I think is that after an amount of time, people sort of accept you for what you are, you know. Yeah. We've never been sort of, you know, faces. We've never been able to say, you know, this is us biased for the looks and stuff. We've only ever said, like, you know, here's the song.
Well, in Leaving Me Now, which we're going to come up shortly, you start off as Archie Rice, OK? But we see you wiping off the makeup, taking off the suit, and you're back to being good old Mark, and it's back to being Level 42 again. So you've shed the image.
Yes, that's right, yeah. Definitely. Archie Rice to Uncle Ben's, right?
Do you enjoy doing videos, or do you find they're sort of like a bit of a chore that you sort of get pinned down to doing?
No, I think, you know, the idea of being, like, in a band and wanting to be on stage, the old ego of showing off in front of people, is damned attractive being in front of a camera and getting into the idea of, what you've got to do is you sort of got to get out of the attitude of it sort of thinking small, which is a quite a hard thing to do. Because, like, musicians are musicians, we're not actors. Actors have the great ability to be able to act out. When you're like a musician like us, you're trying to think of everything as like a joke. So you go, well, I'd really like to get into this, but I can't because I'm just too cool.
You know? Is that why, like, in a lot of your videos, we see you guys performing on one side and then we see sort of someone else doing...
That's why the videos are bloody awful. That's right. They're not very good at it. Now, the videos are good to do. I enjoy them. Enjoy them a lot.
And do you have any say in their creation? I mean, like, well, you know, the one on the train, for instance, it sounded like your story.
Well, yes, it is and it isn't. What you do is you can perhaps have a germ of an idea, which then you sort of spread it to the director, you know. David, who sat up there now, would tell you that he basically sort of envisages the thing. You just say, look, I see it as like being really sunny, you know, and I think it would be nice to have some wacky old dancing because it's a good fun thing, you know. Do it. And so then he thinks, oh, gosh, you know, and he sorts out with a production company where you're going to do it, like a location. Yeah. I mean, the idea was that we thought that it might be nice if it looked a bit sort of, if we were in Egypt on sand dunes and stuff. It was really done in a gravel pit in Norfolk. But another funny thing, too, is that on that old one is that, like, we sort of got incredibly red because during the
shooting through the day, we actually get really sunburned. So you end up sort of, you begin as this pasty white thing and end up as like Lobster Man.
Yeah. Well, now that, you know, you've got a new album out and all that sort of thing, you're about to go and crack America, what do you feel your personal musical ambitions now? I mean, would you perhaps like to try keyboards or something? Are you know, you're a drummer, you're a bassist, now that we've got these great synths and stuff.
No, I wouldn't like to try that, you know. Like it's not quite... you know, it doesn't quite work like that. You know, I can't think that, well, you know, to hell with this, you know. I'm going to try being a keyboard player. You know, I am what I am. It's just like the bass player, and sort of my life's work up until now in terms of music has been as a bass player and singer with Level 42. Mm. Whatever's going to happen in the future, I don't know, you know. I would like to do another solo album. I did one once. Yeah. Died.
Well, now we've got the title track of your current album, Running in the Family. Jazzy little number on a, well, chessboard or something, isn't it?
Yeah, it's sort of, it's meant to be a game show thing. Wacky little vid, this.
Our dad would send us to our room, be the voice of doom. He said that we would thank him later. All day he was solid as a rock, but by 8 o'clock we'd be grumbling. One night my brother Joe and me climbed down the family tree that grew outside our bedroom window. We ran though we knew we couldn't last, running from the past, things that we were born to be. Looking back it's so bizarre, it runs in the family. Circumstances. He said two kids out on the street were picked up on the beaten in the station. So there's me with Emily and Joe and Daddy driving home, all heading in the same direction. He knew no matter what the brakes, we'd make the same mistakes. Couldn't take his eyes off Joe and me. Looking back, it's so bizarre. It runs in the family.
That looks like a lot of fun. Do you enjoy doing that one?
Yes, it was good fun. I think that's one thing you can see sort of going through the video, sort of this fast, you know, one thing, your hair grows.
<This fast. laughs>
You know, your hair gets really long all of a sudden. And it's funny to see how you sort of do tend to relax. I suppose you get used to it, you know? Yeah. And a way to get through, like, a long day, because you start shooting, you know, very early, at 6 in the morning. That's a lie, I know, but it sounds good. You start shooting about 6 in the morning to about midnight at night. And so, you know, you laugh.
With this album, do you think you've... take you on. With the new album, Running Phone, do you think you've sort of crossed over to a more commercial sound, perhaps? I mean, Ready for America?
Oh.
You can say no. Yes.
No, of course we have. I mean, I'm trying... Yes, we have, because it's been our most successful album to date. Therefore, it's more commercial. I didn't sit down when I was writing this stuff thinking... I need another something about you. I need another Lessons in Love or anything. Each song, you do the best for each song that you can for that song, which is why, you know, Running in the Family doesn't sound like Lessons in Love, or It's Over doesn't really sound like Running in the Family or something.
And, like, when you look back over the past, does everything tend to just, like, merge together into one big tour, or are there specific things that excite you still about, you know, that stand out?
Oh, so you're going to let the old link to It's Over go, then, are you?
We'll come up to that.
Yeah, no, there are things that excite me about the past. Is that what you said?
Yes, that's what I said.
You know, those are the days. Looking down in the bath.
Well, we've done the past. Let's talk about the future. What's coming up in the next few months for you?
Well, back to America again. You know, I like it over there. We've got another 4 months. We're opening for Tina Turner from the 1st of November to the 21st of December. And
Don't worry. Well, we've got a video coming up now. Listen, Mark, I wish you all the best in your coming tour. I hope you crack America. Sounds like you're going to, mate. Now, we're going to finish up with another track from the recent album. It's definitely one to snuggle up to at home. Now, I've just had the best interview with Level 42. It's been terrific.
Oh, thank
but
you.
But I'm sorry to say, we've got to say to you all, it's over.
That was awful.
It hasn't stopped.
My friends in Prague and the Czech Republic. I'm Mark King from Level 42, and you're here in my studio. Just going to show you, it's a bit of a mess, I have to say, but it's a working studio, and there's all kinds of things. Let me just show you around quickly. What have we got there? Oh, we got all kinds of guitars and stuff. And what have we got here? We've got MPCs, we've got some TC Electronic amps, and I've got all kinds of things. Davros's Dalek chair there, look. Computers for days, Macintosh stuff. A lot of bases up on the walls. Yeah, that's an old Strat there. And what have we got here? Bit of an old Gibson hiding around there. This is my mobile rack. This is what we record Level 42 on the road with. Look at that. Da-da-da. It's like James Bond. What else? Have we got a drum room in there? There's it's where I get Gary and Pete Ray Biggin come in and play, and note the egg boxes on the walls. You can't take the farmer out of the man, that's what I always say. So, let's get that back. Yeah, there we are. Get Davros's chair out of the way. I'm just going to string up my Status 30th anniversary bass guitar, made for me by Rob Green. You'll see it lights up and it says Mark King, and it says 30th, Level 42, 30th anniversary in their beautiful bass. I've worked with Rob for many years now, and he's really looked after me, come up with the goods, and we sat down about 11 years ago now, to come up with the shape and the design for this bass guitar, which we thought we'd call the King Bass. And I love them, absolutely love them. And every couple of years or so, me and Rob get together again and we tweak away at stuff. And we have another one in the pipeline at the moment where we're working on some parametric EQ, which is going to be very exciting. So I'll keep you posted on that one. Let's just get some strings on here. These are hot wire strings. I also get these from Rob Green as well, from Status. And they're very nice. They're double ball ends, as you can see. I have, it makes changing strings very quick and easy because you have a ball at each end of the string, hence the double ball end. And I always find that two balls are better than one for many things in life. And I use very light gauge strings, actually. I use 30, 50, 70 and 90, which is very quite light for bass guitar strings. But it's when I started playing bass in Macari's music shop in London in 1979. They had an old Gibson EB, an EB-O? Or an EB3, I can't remember now. It's the semi-acoustic one anyway. Maybe it's an EB2. And that was short scale. And so the strings that were on it were really very light. And that's kind of what I've stuck with because they were very nice and comfortable to play and I could bend them. And as I wasn't particularly fussed about being a bass guitarist, I just wanted to play drums, really. I just didn't really follow the normal rules that bass players are supposed to follow, you know, sort of stand at the back of the stage and dribble. So, it was all right. Nearly got these strings on, guys. And then what I'll do is I'll crank up a bit of music and just have a quick jam with myself. Yeah, there's been such a change in the way music's made these days. Home recording is where it's at. And you can do everything nowadays, you know, with the computers that we have available. I mean, I've just been a Macintosh user since 1985. I had my first Mac SE. And I was introduced to it by Wally Badderer, of course, the great Wally, who was always insane with Macs. He'd very often have two going at the same time, which we always thought was hilarious in the studio because we didn't really catch on to what the computer thing was all about. Of course, nowadays, I've got four Macs in this studio. I've got, goodness knows how many indoors. It's just the way of it these days, isn't it? Plus iPhones and iPads and... I'll just have a quick tweak of this. And see where we're at. Let's plug in here. Better tune it. Always good to tune the bass. It's sharp. When you use strings on, you can stretch them in quite easily. Not that easily, though. And that's one thing we had to sort of put in on this bass is that where that bit of writing is a called a bend well. So it gives you a nice little... Do things like that. That's pretty good. Okay. Very good. Next thing is gaffer tape. Yeah, give me some gaffer tape. This is something I just stick around my thumb to protect my thumb, really. This is something I've done since 1981 when we first went into Europe, opening for the Police, and we got some gigs in Holland on our own after that. And I got really carried away one night and split my thumb, and it was extremely painful. And I've never done it since. Every night I just wrap my thumb up now, and I've been doing it so long It feels really odd to play without a bit of tape on. Although, you know, I don't recommend it for everybody. It's you lose something of the feel. Oh, nice, yeah. Come in. Right, this is a bit of Gaddafi Duck. This is something that I sort of put together to play with my friends at the bass guitar show. I hope it comes out all right on there. We'll be right back. See ya.
Goodbye.